shapeshift.io. This is the fastest way to swap bitcoins and dozens of other cryptocurrencies. No account is needed. Watch this. Let's say you have Bitcoin and you want Namecoin. Step 1. Select Bitcoin here. And Namecoin here. Notice the deposit limit and minimum for your deposit. Step 2. Provide your Namecoin address here, an optional Bitcoin return address here. Step 3. Send Bitcoin to the provided deposit address, and it will be converted for you in seconds. No accounts, no emails, no passwords, no waiting. Shapeshift.io, the fastest way to swap coins. Enjoy.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to a new episode of the Bitcoin Report. This week, we have a guest, and his name is Eric Voorhees. Maybe you know him.
Hello.
And he is the CEO of Shapeshift.io, and that's it's an exchange, but not like an ordinary exchange. It's much simpler. So you can put some cryptocurrency into their system, and you can get another cryptocurrency out of it. Do I explain it? It's simple like that.
It's kind of like a vending machine. You just walk up and you put some coins in, and out comes a candy bar. But instead of candy bar, it's other kinds of cryptocurrency.
Yeah, the idea for that service, it was a long time ago that you start to think about it.
It was like a couple weeks after I left Coinapult, which was the company I was with in 2013. And I thought I wanted to buy some altcoin. I don't even remember what it was, but I just wanted to gamble on it basically and get some $500 worth or whatever. And I realized it was going to take all afternoon because I was going to have to sign up with an account and an exchange and deposit money and wait for all the confirmations and then put in a bid order and wait for it to fill. Withdraw, which can take up to a day sometimes from some of these exchanges, and just became quite a task to get some coins. And I thought, this is ridiculous. In the cryptocurrency world, I should be able to snap my fingers and change any coin into any other coin as easily as sending an email. So that's what I went to go about building.
Yeah, and can you explain how the process works to our viewers? So, what steps they have to take to trade their cryptos?
So, let's say you have a Bitcoin and you really like the whole Ethereum concept, so you want to buy some Ether. You come to Shapeshift.io. You don't have to sign up for an account or anything like that. You just select, you know, that you have Bitcoin and that you want Ethereum, and then you put in your Ethereum address and you click Start. And then Shapeshift gives you a Bitcoin deposit address, and you send your Bitcoin to that address, and then we shoot Ethereum out at you. And that's it. So the whole thing can really be done in 30 seconds, and it's fully available via API, so other websites and bots can use it to acquire assets easily. So it's really built to be a very simple way to change any digital asset into any other digital asset.
Yeah, and what transfer rates do you charge?
So the rates always change. So all these coins are traded at various traditional order book exchanges. That's how these prices get discovered. So Shapeshift is always watching the prices of all these coins at every exchange that we plug into, which is five or six. And based on whatever lowest rate we see out in the marketplace, we take that, we consider variables like the spread, the volatility, and then we add a margin, which is, becomes our profit. And so the exchange rate that the user sees is the exact rate that they get, which includes the revenue for Shapeshift.
Yeah, is it an average of multiple exchanges, or you're using one exchange?
Well, the lowest. So if we see five exchanges that are selling Bitcoin and Litecoin, the price at all those exchanges will be in a range. So we have a range of prices. Shapeshift takes the bottom one, and then based on a number of variables, adds some amount of margin to it. So the price that you get at Shapeshift for a liquid market like Bitcoin to Litecoin should roughly be an average of the best rates out there and the worst rates out there, something sort of in the middle. So, but much faster and much safer because people don't have to store money at the exchange and hold it there. So it's meant to make things very easy. And I think, you know, one of the big tasks for any Bitcoin company is to make these services really easy for people to use. And it's been a long process. And it'll continue to do that until the stuff becomes commonplace.
Yeah, because I think this Shapeshift is more for mainstream buyers than day traders and professional sellers.
Yeah.
Can you do day trading with it?
You can. It has an API, so you can write bots that use it as a market. So there are people who watch Shapeshift as a marketplace. We'll sometimes do arbitrage between different things. But in general, since Shapeshift doesn't have limit orders, only market orders, basically, we tell you the price that we can sell it to you at this moment. Since we don't have limit orders, normal day traders don't use it so much. But we figured out how to do limit orders, so can't talk too much about that yet. But suffice to say, in 2016, Shapeshift will be a pretty exciting place.
What will Shapeshift do in 2016? Are they rolling out more services? Because we already really see the API use in different websites, altcoin websites, and where you can shift the coin from that page itself.
Yep.
Can you lift the curtain a bit about what's in store in 2016, or is it all classified?
It's not all classified. So from what people will be able to see, we have a CoinCap. A mobile app coming out. CoinCap.io is our sort of sister site that we built to show pricing in real time for all digital assets. And we're building a really cool mobile app for that for iPhone right now. We also have a new website coming out for Shapeshift, which when we started Shapeshift, it was just Bitcoin and Litecoin. That was the one pair that people could trade. It was no advanced features or anything. And so we've, over the last year and a half, kept adding features and adding things to that design. And it's gotten to the point where I think it's now kind of confusing to a new person. So with knowing all that we've learned, we are redoing the whole website to be streamlined and very simple again. So that's coming soon. And then as I alluded to, we'll have limit orders available. So that will mean that people can do, you know, normal professional trading at Shapeshift. And beyond that, I think the other things I'll keep secret for now, but we're always trying to build bigger and better. And yeah. And I guess, you know, in the back end, there's a lot of work we always are trying to do to get our pricing better. So, you know, trying to build algorithms to handle that more safely. It's a very difficult problem in the crypto markets because these markets are not liquid. A $500 order can move the price of some of these coins by 5 or 10%. And so it's really hard to price some of this stuff. That problem will tend to go away over time as these markets mature, but we're also trying to get better at it ourselves.
Yeah, how do you pick the coins that you're having on the site? Because it's not all altcoins. Are you looking to coins that have shady creators, or how do you?
Well,
there are enough coins to have that, of course.
Yeah, one rule of the altcoin world is that every coin has people calling it a scam. And that's true even for Bitcoin, of course. Much of the world still thinks Bitcoin itself is a scam. And some of these coins are scams. We try to avoid those, but generally we just add coins that people are trading actively. So if you go to coincap.io, you see they're ranked by the market cap of these coins. And generally the coins that have a high market cap and a high trading volume, and the trading volume is actually more important, are the ones that we want to add. Some of the coins are very easy to add because they are essentially clones or forks of Bitcoin. And some are very difficult because they're entirely different code bases like Ripple. So if something is difficult to add and low on that list, it's unlikely we'll add it. If it's easy to add and high volume, then we'll probably add it. But we've added, you know, I think we're at about 42 coins or something, and we have most of the popular ones. So our work right now is not in just continuing to add coins that people don't really care about that much, but in really improving the core service for those coins that people are trading actively.
Yeah. Do you have a favorite altcoin?
The only other altcoin I own a little bit of NXT, and I own some Ethereum. Other than that, I pretty much just assume that by owning and running Shapeshift, I have essentially a stake in the entire industry of non-Bitcoin assets. So that's pretty much my position on it.
Yeah, my idea was, because Shapeshift exists, I thought, well, many people are running out of the altcoin community. Myself also, I've got burned a lot with investing in altcoins. And my problem was I really believed in some coins.
Yeah.
Was the problem, because I believed in the people behind it. The traders, it's such a mess in that area. If the market cap goes high, people let it drop. So I'm out. So can you imagine it?
Yeah, there are a lot of people get burned with this stuff. I think it's important to understand that most of these altcoins will not exist. Like, it's a very high turnover industry. Everyone's experimenting with this stuff. A lot of coins will try out interesting things and fail, or they'll do something that's not really interesting or useful and they'll fail. So most coins, people, even those who are interested in the altcoin world, should assume will fail. But there will be a number of, I think, sort of celebrity coins that end up rising through the ranks, having staying power. And in general, it'll be the coins that do something unique and useful that Bitcoin doesn't quite do. So Bitcoin's really good for a lot of purposes and in a lot of ways, but it can't do everything for everyone. And so any coin or asset that provides a unique and useful service has some economic value. And those are the ones which tend to survive. And some of those might get quite big.
Yeah. I thought Bitcoin can upgrade the software. So most features other coins have can be implemented in Bitcoin.
It's partly true. It's true in that Bitcoin is always evolving. It's open source software, so in theory, you can add lots of new features to it if they prove useful in other coins. It's not true, though, that that's either easy or that it will always be done, or that a feature will necessarily be wanted by everyone. So as an easy example, take a coin like Nubits or Tether or BitUSD. Those three coins are all pegged to the value of $1. And they do it in different ways, but they all do a reasonably good job of maintaining a value at a dollar. Bitcoin can't do that. It shouldn't do that. It shouldn't try to do that. It is having both of those assets, one that's pegged to a dollar and one that floats freely, both of those things are useful. And so you could never, you know, merge Nubits feature into Bitcoin. That would be silly and pointless and destructive. So that's an easy example. You can have other examples like Ethereum, which are built in a totally new and different way in order to enable smart contracts much more easily. Can that get incorporated into Bitcoin? Theoretically, and you have things like Rootstock, projects like Rootstock trying to do that in Bitcoin. So maybe it'll work, maybe it won't, and maybe both will work in different ways and both be useful. So it shouldn't be assumed that anything can just be stuck onto Bitcoin because sometimes if you stick things onto Bitcoin, it might make it worse, and it's better as a separate system. So ultimately, the market will figure this stuff out. And I think it's true that there will be a lot of digital assets that do all sorts of interesting things, but there will be not duplicate assets that each do the same thing. So you won't have two coins that do exactly the same thing. One will win out over the other.
Yeah, one thing, altcoins always saying that they are a lot faster than Bitcoin.
Well, it's true that some coins can confirm faster. It's not true that necessarily means they're more secure. But there may be use cases in the world where getting to that first confirmation is really important. And if that's the case, and Bitcoin takes 10 minutes and other coins take less, then there could be an economic use for those coins and those purposes. I think in general, just having a faster block is not enough of an additional feature to make something stand out. I'm not bullish on Litecoin long term. I think it doesn't do enough unique. Although I think it stays around as the best backup to Bitcoin, essentially, because we all know that some terrible tragedy could befall Bitcoin, some zero-day exploit or something that people overlooked and just falls apart for whatever reason. That's always possible. So the fact that there's a sort of a second place coin that's almost identical is good. It's healthy for the ecosystem for that to be there. And the price of that should be something over zero.
Yeah. And sidechains, what's your opinion about it to speed up transactions?
So sidechains can do all sorts of things. One thing they can do is provide coins that on which speed up transactions. Some people sort of see sidechains as a way, as something that will eliminate altcoins. And I think that's a misnomer. It's certainly, even if it's very successful, it won't eliminate altcoins. All it means is altcoins will be built on the Bitcoin blockchain. There will be different assets, but they'll all be on the Bitcoin blockchain. And those assets will trade against each other with different prices, just like altcoins do. So it'll change the way that altcoins are built, but it doesn't remove the need for different types of assets. And as long as there are different types of assets in the world, you're going to have different pricing in those assets.
Yeah. All right. About the big consensus debate, my guests, I ask about their opinions about it. There is this, well, I'm on Reddit a lot. There are many different communities, but the last days, there is some kind of a consensus going on. Even Andreas Antonopoulos said we are close. Do you think we are close to a consensus? On both sides?
I don't know. I mean, we're closer than we were a year ago because we've done a lot of debating, and I think the positions are closer together than they used to be. You have the situation where a bunch of core devs are very, very hesitant to cause a hard fork, which increases the block size. I'm totally sympathetic to that. I understand the concern. I understand the risk of making big changes in a $6 billion project. If it's done, it needs to be done with extreme caution and prudency. So I get it. I don't fault them for being careful. And on the other hand, you have, I think, the majority of the community who wants a bigger block size and wants it soon, soon being in 2016. And even the people who don't want the hard fork and to increase the block size, it's more that they don't want to do it yet, or they want to wait and see, or they no one's really saying we will never increase the block size. They just want to do it differently. And so there's a lot of nuances to the debate, and it makes it very tricky because it's not just two positions. There's lots of differences. And even the people who want to increase the block size don't agree on how much and how fast. And it's difficult. So it's certainly Bitcoin's biggest challenge right now. I think there will be a huge rally if and when consensus is achieved on that. But that consensus may not happen for another year. It may be an issue that the community deals with for years. And it's okay. I mean, it's the downside to a decentralized project that there's no, you know, strong leader to make the decisions, but it's better this way. It's better to have slow, measured progress, even if it results in lots of arguing with people on the internet, than to have a wise dictator who would guide us along the path. So the process just needs to play out. I think all the options, whether blocks get bigger faster or remain smaller for a while, they all result in a certain kind of Bitcoin. And a lot of services will be built to augment whatever kind of Bitcoin we have. So a Bitcoin that is very poor for normal day-to-day transactions will encourage businesses built on top of it that may be off-chain, which help people do instantaneous quick transactions with Bitcoin. The entrepreneurial industry will solve whatever problems Bitcoin as a protocol has. So I'm not super worried about it. It's just a difficult struggle to go through for everyone.
It's I think it's a beauty also from Bitcoin. We never used to use a service or something that needs consensus from a big party. So it's very new. I think it's the beauty of Bitcoin that we have to learn to fight for to come up with one idea. So I think it's the pressure that's being pushed on by the community. I think that's not a good thing because it takes how long it takes, I guess.
Yeah. I'm sympathetic to all sides. I think my personal opinion at this point is a block size increase should probably happen with a hard fork in 2016. It can be a small increase, just up to 2 megabytes or up to 4 or something. I think enough of the community really wants that to happen that it kind of needs to, and it should be used to educate and inform the discussion thereafter. So if such a hard fork is done and the cap raised, we'll get a lot of information, right? If it's a huge, messy fork, tons of drama and controversy, and the price goes all over the place because everyone's worried about it, we need to know that. We need to know how damaging and dangerous a hard fork can be. On the other hand, if it happens really smoothly, and we don't see a huge drop in node count or big complaints from miners, then we know that such forks and increasing of block sizes are less problematic than some have worried. So it seems that we need to jump into that pool this year with some size increase, because a huge portion of the community, and maybe the majority, is not going to be happy or content until we at least try that. That probably needs to happen, and how and when, I guess, are interesting debates to have. But the core team really doesn't seem to want to do a hard fork at all in 2016 with a block size increase, and they're pretty firm about that. So I don't know what to do about it.
Exciting times,
yeah. And ultimately, ultimately the decentralization of the whole thing is both its greatest strength and its curse. Yeah. If a huge majority of people really want to increase the block size and only core devs are saying no, there will be a hard fork that's done not by the core devs, by miners or something. And that could be a lot messier. So yeah, hopefully the core devs are thinking of that.
BTC China announced they want a hard fork if the consensus is not reached in China. Mm-hmm. What is your opinion about that?
I don't know.
It's a very blunt statement from BTCC, yeah. I guess.
I think
they want to force something on the community.
Everyone wants to push Bitcoin forward in the way that they think is best, right? And so it's if you have an opinion, it's good to try to push it forward, and it's best to talk with other people and get agreement. But if there's no agreement, then people have to act, and that action can be dangerous, for good or bad. So I hope that statements like that will help the core devs realize that this isn't just a bunch of people on Reddit being loud and obnoxious, that there are people who have substantial understandings of Bitcoin and have considerable business interests in the success of the project who want to go a certain way. It doesn't mean that they're right, but it means that their opinions should be strongly considered, I think.
And about the ongoing wars. On another subject, I got a question from one of my viewers. They said, how does Eric feels about being an early adopter? How much was the Bitcoin when you started? And did you mine yourself?
I mined a little bit for fun. I made a 4 GPU computer and mined for several months in 2011. Lost all that trading. So when I first learned about Bitcoin, it was early May of 2011. Bitcoin was about $5. And by the time I decided to buy some, a few days later, it was $8 or $9. So I'd lost like half of the ability to buy it that I would have had in just a few days. And so I arrived essentially right before the first bubble up to $31. So I was baptized sort of in a fiery cauldron of volatility.
Yeah, we do very volatile if you look at the price now. So
yeah, well, and it's so stable now. People don't appreciate that Bitcoin only moves usually 1-3% a day, which is pretty average for a stock on a stock market.
Yeah,
even big blue chip stocks will move that amount. Oil moves more than that many days, so as does gold. Yeah. So the old trope that Bitcoin is this extremely volatile thing is becoming less true. It's still volatile. It's still much more volatile than the dollar. But it is earning stability over time. And I think a lot of people don't quite appreciate that as much. I mean, the bubble that I was in 2011, there were coins that were $31, and over 8 months, they fell down to $2. That's like 95% loss in value. So it's in this last bubble from 1100 down to 200, you know, that's 80% drop. So
the Gox bubble,
right? So it's normalizing over time.
And what's contributing to it? What do you think is contributing to the stability? Is it only exchange, the number of exchanges, or
it's mostly an increase in the breadth and diversity of the economy. So Bitcoin is larger. There are more people using it for more things. It is more valuable. It's more stable. You know, any financial asset that is larger is as a general rule going to be more stable. It's the same principle that like a canoe is tippier than a cruise ship. It takes more energy to move prices when it's a big thing. That, you know, that's why the US dollar is so stable, because it's one of the biggest, most liquid assets in the world. It's not stable because the US government makes currency stable. Yeah. It's stable because it's huge. And as Bitcoin grows, people should expect that it would achieve stability over time.
Yeah.
It's not something that can be programmed or designed. It's something that has to be earned over many years in the marketplace.
Yeah. On another subject, the Bitcoin, the Bit license. It's a while ago.
That's my favorite subject.
Yes, I know. it's a while ago, so the dust has settled a bit. If you're watching in retrospect about your decision, can you tell me about it? I think you made a good decision, but can you explain that?
Yeah, so the Bit license is New York State's license that was legislation that was basically formed as the first, let's call it, cryptocurrency specific legislation of any state, perhaps of any government in the world, I'm not sure. But it explicitly describes lots of things that we felt were unethical, mainly the compulsion to spy on users, to report information about people who are not even accused of crimes to the government. I think that
pre-crime.
I mean, it completely goes against the foundational legal principle that someone is innocent until proven guilty. You know, not only are these people that we're supposed to spy on not proven guilty, they're not even accused of doing anything wrong. So that's a whole nother level. And to say that businesses should take personal valuable information from those people that's not needed for the operation of the business itself, store that information, and then hand it over to other entities to store, thereby putting all that valuable information at risk for identity theft and compromise, which happens all the time, is completely unethical. And it's understandable in the past when payment methods required you to know who the person was. You sort of needed to know personal information because the payment methods were so insecure themselves. But now that we have a secure payment system in Bitcoin, there's really no practical need to know who the person is. And so to force that person to reveal their personal valuable information is outdated and unethical, and Shapeshift was opposed to it. So we blocked New York just before the legislation became law. We wrote up why we think it's wrong. We put it up at a site called pleaseprotectconsumers.org. And we listed other companies that also dropped New York at that time. And so, yeah, I mean, it was a difficult decision because New York's a big market, but it's also not the whole world. And it's not going to be the center of finance in the 21st century. That's for damn sure. We're very glad that we blocked it. It was the right thing to do. I encourage other companies in the industry to do so. You know, if there's ever a time to like stand on principle, this was a really good time for that. And I think a number of other states have seen the response to the Bit license and have been more cautious about the legislation they're writing. They've realized that in hindsight, very few people think that the Bit license was appropriate. So California drafted legislation, which was more reasonable. Either North or South Carolina put out some banking policy that was much more reasonable. So I think New York's Bit license will be remembered as a terrible example for how to do cryptocurrency regulation. And I hope it becomes a terrible example for the rest of the world to avoid.
Yeah, I think we needed that kind of statement at that time. So maybe it had to happen.
Well, someone's got to do it.
Yeah.
Someone's got to do it.
But you were not alone in it. There were multiple companies.
We were not alone in blocking New York. I think we were by far the most vocal about it.
Yeah, on purpose, and it's good because you have to sign in other states to what's happening. They can, investigate.
Yeah, I mean, legislation doesn't happen in a vacuum. Legislators don't want to look bad. They don't want to look like they're crushing business or harming people, which is exactly what the BitLicense does. And so it's important to, I think, stand up and convey that to the world, because not everyone follows this stuff as much as those of us who are in the industry. And so it's really our job to show society why something is wrong. So we tried to do that in one small way with New York.
Do you think they can backtrack from it? Or
I don't know. Ben Losky, the head guy, just kind of...
He's gone.
He peaced out. Yeah, he like conjured up this terrible diktat, threw it out.
Burning building. You run away from the building.
Yeah, and then he ran away and joined the private sector to get, you know, consulting gigs. Yeah. So yeah, I think he wrote
what the government wanted, right?
Well, there's not the government, right? There's lots of individual politicians and bureaucrats, many of whom have different goals, different ideas about how things should be done. He, I think, wanted to be the pioneer of, a lot of these politicians think that they foster innovation, like that innovation comes from the writing that they do in their rules. And when they make their wise rules, civilization flourishes. And they believe that that's how the world works. So I think he saw this Bitcoin world as an interesting new technology, something with a lot of potential. And he's like, I will be the one who crafts the fertile soil in which this industry can bloom here in New York. And he's so misguided and so much hubris, and just the thought that he should be permitted, you know, this unelected guy should be permitted to dictate not only what people do in New York, but in the whole country of the US, and not only the whole country of the US, but the entire world, because Shapeshift is a Swiss company. Why did we have to block New York? Right? We're not a New York company. We're not even a US company. But if you have one customer somewhere, these regulators will often claim jurisdiction over you. So Ben Losky's pen has dictated how businesses all over the world can interact with their customers. And if you think about it, so like in Shapeshift's model, we don't require users to sign up or anything. If we decided to stay operating in New York, we would have to get all that information, which means that we have to get that information on everyone, right? Because if we don't get the information on some internet visitor, we don't know if that person's in New York or not. So that means we are imposing New York's policies on a customer from the Netherlands or from China or from Australia. No legislation should have arms that reach that long. It's just a recipe for widespread harm. And I think it's symptomatic of government growing without bound and without, you know, without prudence.
Yeah. Did know your customer, that you know, who is buying or transferring Bitcoin or altcoins. In the Netherlands, we have a Bitcoin provider, and he has know your customer in place, because they can buy Bitcoin at them. So they want to know if they're not how do you call it, money laundering. Mm-hmm. You know, so is that another problem with your service, that maybe people are using it for the wrong reasons because you don't have KYC?
Any useful tool or service will sometimes be used for bad things, right? That's to not accept that and to know that that's true is to have your head in the sand. Shapeshift specifically, I think, has innovated in a really interesting way, which is that so regulators typically have two main things that they want to ensure, which guides their regulation in this financial world. One is the money laundering aspect, and one is the consumer protection aspect. So Shapeshift meets those objectives, I think, in a very elegant way. It meets the money laundering aspect because every transaction through Shapeshift is public. It's shown on the front page of the site, the coin that comes in, the amount of the coin that comes in, and the coin that goes out. So anyone with cursory knowledge of blockchains can watch those and know that anything that goes in and where it goes, and follow the blockchain that way. So in a sense, we are the most transparent exchange in the entire world, not just in the cryptocurrency world, but in all of finance, right? Show me an exchange somewhere where every trade is made public so that the investigators don't even need to get a warrant. They can just see the flow going through it. Like we are the most transparent exchange of all time. I will make that claim. So if they really care about transparency and following the money trail, they can do that more easily on Shapeshift than any other exchange. And on the consumer protection angle, we built an exchange that doesn't require customer deposits, which again is unique in the world. So we've built to meet the goals of regulators through technology, as opposed to following rules written by politicians that really don't understand the stuff in the first place. So that's sort of our mode of operation. That's what we're trying to do.
Yeah. Well, in talking about that, I was thinking, what actions could the Bitcoin community do to encourage more investments in Bitcoin and in crypto? Because a lot of VC money is drying up. Do you have the feeling that is true?
I think people don't appreciate volatility or variance enough. So we have lots of VCs investing in lots of Bitcoin companies, but there's variance in that. Like these deals are hard to put together. They take time. So you'll get bursts, you'll get a point 6 months or a year where it seems like tons of money is flowing in, and then 6 months or a year where nothing flows in. And that doesn't mean that the economy or interest is slowing down. It's just variance of these deals, totally normal. So I think that's largely there. Unfortunately, a lot of who are considered the most sophisticated financial people in the world, these VCs who allocate capital wisely, according to their websites, they tend to be most interested in industries when they're going through their bubble phases. Like all people, like the average guy on the street is also most interested in Bitcoin when it hits the $1,000 headline. So the investment interest, both from the guy on the street and from the VC, is going to follow the price movements. So it's not a coincidence that we saw the most amount of VC money happen on the backside of the big bubble, because that's when VCs wake up and they say, okay, we need to go make a move, and those deals take months to put together. When the next bubble happens, whenever that is, you'll get a whole new wave of this stuff, and it's natural and it's fine, and people just need to understand that that's how it works.
And we are expecting a lot of bubbles in 2016, I guess. But yeah, after every bubble, I think we have we reach new highs with the price. That's my opinion, because it's
we should hit new highs with each bubble if the system's growing, which it is. I think it's hard to find a metric showing that Bitcoin is shrinking or stagnant. So ultimately, what justifies any price of Bitcoin is the use of it, not just for spending, but for holding money, for doing interesting things like titling records and all the various things that blockchains are going to be doing. That usage is what ultimately justifies the price. But the price doesn't move in a perfect relationship to actual usage. It moves in these big speculative bubbles. I've been through three or four of them now, and they're difficult, but that's just part of the industry.
It's good for PR. Bubbles are good for PR and for making people aware that Bitcoin is here to stay.
Yeah, I mean, it's easy to dismiss Bitcoin after the first bubble. So like in 2011, that was really the first bubble, and lots of people declared it dead. Right, because scams or Ponzi schemes will often have a bubble, and then they go away.
One bubble, yeah.
Right, so after one bubble pops, I can understand someone making fun of Bitcoin and saying that it's dying. But after three or four bubbles, you have to start realizing that it's not just a fad. It is going through cycles of speculative investment. And it deserves a little more respect than people gave it originally.
Is Bitcoin being used in Panama, where you live?
I don't live in Panama anymore.
Oh, well, that's a good understanding.
Yeah, so I'm in Denver, Colorado. So I've been here for CIA, a while.
Are you at the CIA?
The CIA headquarters?
Yeah.
Yeah, they have a suite for me, a beautiful penthouse suite at the CIA headquarters.
Yeah, with lots of cameras.
I help them spy on... innocent people around the world, so get bigger paychecks.
We got a scoop here. Well, thank you very much for being at our show. I think people have learned a lot about Shapeshift and about your opinions on the Bitcoin community and where it's going.
I look forward to meeting you in the new year, and thanks so much for the interview.
Well, happy Bitcoin New Year, and we speak in the next year, and I want you to thank my viewers for watching the show, and I'll see you next week on a new episode of the Bitcoin Report. Have a great day.